last night when we were eating, we had our own kind of convivial moment, all of the presenters. I think I asked, who here is a digital humanist? And we all kind of looked down at our plate at that point. Because we come into this large tent of digital humanities from different, I guess, backgrounds. And of course, some of us have already said, in graduate school, when we were starting out, digital humanities wasn't yet a thing. It wasn't a term. So I come to digital humanities. I don't self-identify as a digital humanist. I'm more comfortable identifying myself as an applied linguist, somebody who is interested in solving, let's say, language problems. There are a lot of language problems, so that's the applied part of it. Usually through kinds of the categories given to me by the field of linguistics. And so what I want to do today is talk about, as Tom said, digital social reading. And I'll be pointing out kind of there are a lot of people who have helped me come into this field, have drawn me in. I see Sam Baker in the back and actually Matthew, who are part of this story. I've also noted that a lot of our speakers, there's an amazing amount of intertextuality, isn't there? We didn't plan all of this, all these, but I hope that there will be some of the resonances with what I have to say with the previous speakers. So I found this, if you do a Google search, and you're like, you're a presenter and you're trying to find interesting images for your talk, right? And you type in social reading, do you know what you get? You get a lot of pictures of classrooms, actually. You get a teacher reading to students. And many of us were, of course, socialized in our own literacy by probably like reading groups. Remember the reading groups? Some people were bluebirds and some people were red and so forth. All right. So that's the social reading. This is also, I think, anywhere where you have people reading to each other or reading together can be construed as somehow a social activity. This is, of course, I know many of us were read to as children, so this is, of course, a sibling reading to her brother, but it's not the old-fashioned text. It's reading something online. So that's really what I'm talking about today. So online reading is changing our understanding of what it means to read by blurring the line between private interpretation and public discussion. The history of marginalia provides a very good illustration. During the 18th century, people routinely marked up books or novels to give as personalized gifts. This practice was intended to give the reader the sense of socializing with another person during the private act of reading. This is a picture of Sam Anderson. Anybody know Sam Anderson? He writes for the New York Times, a book critic. What I really want is someone rolling around in the text. And Sam Anderson wrote this article in 2011. And he's called today's use of digital marginalia a natural bridge between the reader's private and public worlds. Likening the practice of digital marginalia to Twitter, Anderson envisions the day, or envisioned in 2011, the day when readers will instantaneously share their thoughts with each other about whatever they're reading. And he says, and I quote, "I've long been frustrated with the distance between criticism and reading itself. Most critical energy is expended in big picture work, situating text in history, talking about broad themes, all of which is useful, but hardly touches the excitement of actual reading. A process of discovery that happens in time, moment by moment, line by line. What I really want is someone rolling around in the text, I guess with me. I want noticing. I want, in short, marginalia everywhere, all the time." Now, that may not be what you want. I'm not sure exactly what I want, but that was what he was saying. That's what he wanted. Well, Anderson's wish has come true because people are using Twitter for exactly that. And here is an example website which facilitates these discussions, readups.com. In which you can, of course, we could be doing this today. We could be having a handle and you could all be tweeting about my talk right here. So live tweeting reading War and Peace, because I'm not going to read War and Peace by myself. I need some help. And so that's the idea. Another space, I think, for social reading that also has made Anderson's dream come true is genius.com. How many people have seen Genius? Just no? Okay. Well, good. I'm going to bring a really great website to some people to your attention. Genius.com started just a couple of years ago within the hip-hop community people who were talking about the lyrics of hip-hop songs. They wanted to know exactly what they meant. And so they started putting the lyrics online and annotating them and talking to each other about the meaning. So you see here on the interface, it says lyrics, because it was centrally about lyrics. And then it started in hip-hop, okay? But there are other forms of music that have lyrics, so it moved from hip-hop to pop music to classical and on and on and on, finally to opera. And then people said, well, you know, why stop at lyrics? What about literary texts? So then the literary community joined. We now have news. We can annotate news. We can annotate cinema, so different kinds of multimedia texts. And all of these different communities forming around different kinds of texts to annotate them and have a discussion. That's another idea of collaborative annotation that I'll be touching on. So here's really what I want to talk about today. I'll start off with the problem. It's always good because I said my orientation is I like to solve problems. And one of the problems I think that people are talking about today is the deteriorating reading skills. And this is kind of the polemical debate with the old fart professors. Our students just can't read as well as they used to read, right? And I have also said that, so I'm sure we're all old farts at this point. The reason, of course, is digital literacy is replacing real literacy. And then I want to pivot a little bit and borrow from a digital humanist, somebody who self-identifies as a digital humanist, Catherine Hayles, who is an English professor at Duke University. And she talks about types of close reading, hyper-reading and distant reading, as cognitive responses to different environments, media environments. So a voice of reason, I think, in the polemical debate. And then I'd like to talk also about this notion of bridging then the digital literacy and print literacy with this concept of social reading. Give you two case studies, very different. Joanna is a senior lecturer of French at Cornell University using eComma, the software that we have been developing here at the University of Texas. And Joanna uses it with the first semester foreign language course, a French course, and then Chantel Warner, a professor at University of Arizona in German. Chantel used it with a graduate course in second language acquisition, so very different context. And then finally, I've heard the word mentioned by several of the other speakers today, the keyword affordance. So we have a tool, what can you do with this? And that's really one of the things I'm primarily interested in, is you give a tool to teachers or to students, and they're trying to figure out what to do, just as we had a really great presentation, right, of Bauerlein saying, that was a great, they are in an environment, they're trying to figure out what can I do with this. Okay, so, and then if we have time, I really want to get to the demo, because this is all just a pretext to tell you that eComma now exists as a plugin for Canvas and for your other LMSs. It's really easy. We'll show you how we can do it. So technology, here we come. Okay, so let me start off with then the debate. The Dumbest Generation by Mark Bauerlein, 2009. So this is really about disgruntled professors complaining about their students who just can't read literary text and who can't follow then extended arguments. They don't read print. They have short attention spans. What's really interesting here is after the colon here, the title is How the Digital Age Stupefies Young Americans and Jeopardizes Our Future. This guy can't find anything good about the digital era as far as literacy goes as the way he defines literacy. And he cites in this book a lot of evidence that there have been declining skills in reading, of course, based on standardized tests of reading. And that, again, is in 2009. 2010, just a short year later, Nicholas Carr, who's a science writer, science journalist, wrote, I would say, a more reasoned book about this issue, which is called What the Internet is Doing to Our Brains. Much of this, he goes over the research in neuroscience and says what your brain is like on print and what your brain is like on digital. But when you read the two, and I read the two kind of back to back, what struck me was while their tone was quite different, Evaluatively, they're very similar. They use the same kinds of adjectives to describe the print. So students on print, intellectual, deep, calm, attentive, thoughtful. Digital, it's just the polar opposite. Anti-intellectual, shallow, hyperactive, distracted, thoughtless. In fact, that's the name of the book, The Shallows. Obviously, not everybody agrees. In 2013, Clive Thompson wrote a book, and Clive is the head technology writer for the New York Times, Smarter Than You Think. I think the book is about himself. He's smarter than you. So how technology is changing our minds for the better, and actually the middle chapter in the book is all about tools to extend our ability to read and make meaning with in text. So let me sum up this great literacy debate with this image here. I think everybody's talking about reading, but they're talking about very different things when they use the word reading. So this captures it. In fact, the headline actually says, online, are you really reading? What do we mean by reading? So let me stop for just a minute here. And as I said, I was Googling images for this talk. If you type in reading and do a Google image search, you will get a human, but different kinds of humans read different kinds of things. So we find overwhelmingly, if I saw a book in the picture, I would find a woman. Women read books. And interestingly, historically, the woman was reading a piece of literature, right? And it was a very strong correlation. Go ahead, you can try it after this talk and see if I'm right. Men read many different kinds of things. They read newspapers, as we find here. They read sacred texts. They had scrolls. They had things, not really quite the book. And then if I found a younger person, they were reading a Kindle, they were reading something off their laptop and so forth. But the main point for my talk is look at what dad is doing and mom is doing. So dad is reading the newspaper, mom is reading her novel, presumably the book, or it could be something else, I don't know. But the point is they're in their own world, right? That's what we like to do, those of us who've been socialized in literacy. I don't necessarily want a whole lot of other people in my reading space. And certainly they're in their own private world. So they've internalized literacy. It's a private activity. But who knows what the kids are doing? They're probably connected to somebody else as they're reading. This is where I turn to Catherine Hayles, as I said, a digital humanist from Duke University. And this book came out in 2012. It's a terrific book, really interesting book about reading. And reading, what it means to read today. And Hale's argument is this: the age of print is passing, and the assumptions, presuppositions, and practices associated with it are now becoming visible as media-specific practices rather than the largely invisible status quo. A corollary to this is also that we co-evolve as humans with the actual technology that we make. So we invent tools, they help us do something, but then they come back and they change the way we think. Hayles outlines three different kinds of reading. Close reading, which is really quintessential for digital humanities or humanities, right? Teaching people how to read a literary text and to slow down the process and to think about meaning. Hyperreading, as we just heard about, so making connections from the text, going off the text to another text. And then finally, what we can call machine reading, or also known as distant reading now, right? Not close, it's somehow very different than that. So you're not even reading the text at all. The machine is reading it for you. But what I found interesting about Hale's discussion about these different, the tone was not polemical, she actually takes a cognitive approach. So what is it about these three different kinds of reading in terms of cognition? So she describes close reading this way. Close reading correlates with deep attention, the cognitive mode traditionally associated with the humanities that prefers a single information stream, focuses on a single cultural object for a relatively long time, and has a high tolerance for boredom. I don't know how, again, thinking in terms of how we've been socialized, but I'm socialized to such an extent in the print era that I will read a book and I will doggedly finish the book, even though I hate the books. I'm 200 pages into the book and I've got to finish it. So I have a high tolerance for literacy boredom because of my training in print. Hyperreading, then, she describes this way. Hyperreading is a strategic response to an information-intensive environment, aiming to conserve attention by quickly identifying relevant information so that only relatively few portions of a given text are actually read. Hyperreading correlates with hyperattention, a cognitive mode that has a low threshold for boredom, alternates flexibly between different information streams, and prefers a high level of stimulation. So that starts to look like some of our students, right? Okay, but again, in terms of evaluation, the way she was framing it was quite different. She's approaching it in terms of this is a really intelligent response to the environment. Finally, machine reading. Although machine reading may be used with a single text and reveal interesting patterns, its more customary use is in analyzing corpora too vast to be read by a single person. And so there are many synonyms for this, so information extraction, concordancing, pattern recognition, data mining, distant reading, following Franco Moretti's work. So another very important point of Hayles is, okay, we have these different kinds of readings today, and they are real, and they exist, and they have good cognitive reasons for these different kinds of styles of reading. She said we've also then entered this tipping point. And she cited lots of evidence for this that students today, well, I'll read this quote, courses and curricula recognize all three reading modalities, close, hyper, and machine, reading, and prepare students to understand the limitations and affordances of each. That's what we should be doing right now at higher education, because we've already hit the tipping point. Most of the students coming into Duke University, this again is 2012, so it's already passed, have had more experience reading digital text than print text. That was her claim. This correlation then suggests the need for pedagogical strategies that recognize the strengths and the limitations of each cognitive mode. By implication, they underscore the necessity for building bridges between them. Okay, let's turn then to social reading. What is that? And this is a nice definition from Joanna Lux, actually. I cited her. She's the senior lecturer at French at Cornell, who is playing around with this idea of social reading. And she defines it this way, an internet-based activity in which a group of people collaboratively reads, annotates, and comments upon a shared text. And this is why I cited her, because then she turns and talks about it more in pedagogical parlance. One could say that it constitutes a during reading activity, which I thought was great. So we're used to talking about pre-reading and post-reading, but suddenly we just give them the text and we say, go read. Okay, so this is focused on the actual act of reading itself. So during reading, or just reading. Now, it's a little bit more complicated than social reading actually comes in different forms when you start to think about it. You can read the same text at the same time with a group of people. I think most of the time that's what people mean by social reading. Or you can read the same text at different times, so an asynchronous, give your class a text and then as a homework assignment, and they're all then writing their commentary around that. Or, of course, you can have a group of people reading different texts, but we're following them kind of reading, so we're aggregating in some way their reading activity. Okay? Let me give you a couple of examples, because since we started this at COERLL, and even the genesis of eComma, which started before a couple of years previous to that, and I'll get to the story there, there has been an explosion of annotation software. This has really taken off. So here's an example of reading the same text at the same time. This is something called Classroom Salon, which is a tool that was developed at Carnegie Mellon. It's an environment where you can set it up as a classroom, and then people are talking and annotating the text at the same time. It works also, not when I say text, it could be multimedia, so you can annotate a video, for example. Reading the same text at different times, so there are now lots of different sites that have started that are like virtual book clubs, basically. People who, as I mentioned, want to read a classic, but they need a little bit of help in doing that. So it's the same idea of you've signed up for a gym membership, but you're really not going to use it, and so you need a buddy, you need somebody else to help you along. All right, and finally, reading different text. This is an interesting website called Ponder, and what I particularly like about this is their logo, P, and then after that, think, then share, as opposed to the internet activity of share. Just stop and think. Ponder just a bit before you share. And this works on what they call deconstructing the reading response by giving them, you can annotate a text, but you choose your annotations, and, so it has what they call micro responses to a text. So down here, I question the relevance, I detect artifice, I'm intrigued, etc. Or devices for persuasion, oh, slippery slope, that's an appeal to fairness, and so forth. So they give them essentially these prefabricated responses to text. And what you can do then quickly with this particular, on this particular website and set it up as a classroom, and it's free for educators, you can follow people as they're reading, maybe in the New York Times. Some people like to read editorials. Some people like to read different things. You can follow what they're reading, but you can also see what kinds of reactions they have to text. So going back to reader response theory, you can kind of aggregate their response. Okay, so another point then is there are many different kinds of tools now being used for what's called social reading. And on our website at COERLL, just type in eComma and you come to the website. We want to show then how these different tools differ. And as you notice, of course, eComma, which is our tool that I'll be talking about in just a moment, is free. But not all of them are free. Some of them maybe come bundled with another document that you have to purchase as like a textbook. Since we are making products, the whole point of COERLL is to create OER, open educational resources. We make sure that all of our materials are open. They carry open copyright, are actually open source. This was it's an open source product. So all that to say that there are lots of new tools out there for annotation, but they are quite different. They do different things. The master metaphor, I think, in reading around social reading has been the text as a space, a space for socializing. And this was an article I came across in the Chronicle of Higher Education. This is a professor, a digital humanist at NYU, and he created the Thomas More's Utopia, and he wanted to put it online. He didn't create it. He put it online. And he had his students then create this commentary. What actually was interesting for me was just the serendipity of, as I was reading this article, this popped up, right? The new library. And so, again, the library is the old space where you go to the text. Here we are all, we meet together in virtual space to talk around the text. So the text is a space. And of course, the text is a space not just for socializing, but also for learning. So subtext is, this works on iPads. So proprietary software, but here it's a digital classroom. The space becomes a digital classroom. This, of course, is what I'll be talking about, and that this is eComma, a collaborative for collaborative reading. I published a chapter in a book, actually edited by Lawrence Williams back there. On the book was about digital literacies and foreign languages, and I told a little bit of the chronology of eComma, which started with Sam Baker, professor of English here at UT, who applied for a national, it was a startup grant, right? A National Endowment for the Humanities startup grant, with a small group of collaborators, graduate students, including Matthew Russell. So this is nice, and Travis Brown. They were developing this tool, and I actually saw Sam was giving a presentation. And I went to, because they had just built this great tool, and he was talking about it, and he was talking about the idea of close reading of literary texts. That's what humanists do. But he was, of course, talking about it in terms of the, I guess you were talking about a freshman English classroom. And I kept thinking to myself, everything we do in foreign languages is close reading, to the point where we look up words, we have to parse the sentence, who's doing what to whom. It's all close reading. And so I became very interested in this tool. Long story short, when we got the grant to develop COERLL, Natalie Steinfeld, so all things technology, that's what Natalie's doing. She's a web designer, graphic artist for COERLL. She started to reprogram eComma in Drupal, which is an open content management system. We wanted to make this as open to the public as possible. And today, I'm really happy because it now is working. It's a plugin for, I think, the kind of killer app now. It's a plugin for Canvas or for Blackboard. It's really easy to use, finally. So the main idea here is to start with students' own digital practices as a natural part for training them in other kinds of literacy instruction. In other words, that was really what Catherine Hale's point was. You start with students. You start where they are. Instead of wishing that they were something that they're not, let go of that nostalgia, and just teach the student in front of you. So what can they do? Well, they have all these new talents in digital literacy. Let's build a bridge then to the things that we want to teach them about print literary texts. And I bumped into Sam a couple days ago, and he said he was coming. I kind of changed my slides quickly. To take advantage of this opportunity, I knew he would be in the, and so this is exactly what I saw him do. I went and visited a couple of his classes, and he was at the time talking about The Wasteland by T.S. Eliot. So let me just read, this gives you their original layout. So here we have the text on the left, and then we have a word cloud, and you see here in the box, the blue and the red. So the blue are going to be comments, and the red are going to be tags. And I'll explain that in just a minute. But that was the interface. So let me read the first stanza here. The river's tent is broken. The last fingers of leaf clutch and sink into the wet bank. The wind crosses the brown land unheard. The nymphs are departed. Sweet Thames, run softly till I end my song. Remember, there's only two things to do in this program. You tag or you comment. You drag your cursor over a piece of text, and then you tag it or you comment about it. And a tag usually is a single word. A comment is a little bit more developed. Not too developed, because nobody wants to read a paragraph. They just want to read a sentence or two. What I became interested in is, when do students do close reading, what we conceptualize as close reading in this environment? When do they do hyper reading? And when might they do this new thing called machine reading? What I witnessed in Sam's English, freshman English classes is that, yes, they do a lot of close reading. They discuss a lot word meaning, basically. So here we have somebody who has underlined the word sink. And he says, sinking refers to negative things happening. If something is sinking, it is going down and can also sometimes symbolize defeat. And because this is social, people respond to each other. Agreed, the harder one tries to get out of sinking sand, the further they sink. Kind of the same idea. So the whole point of social reading is that you get into back and forth between each other. You're not just reading the text, you're reading each other, reading the text. So they talk about lexical meaning. They talk, obviously, about metaphors. So here, somebody says, the river's tent is broken. They've highlighted that part of the text and write, the river seems to be mentioned because the river is supposed to flow, yet it is broken. Meaning that the flow of the land in place could be broken. Something is not right. And I won't read through all of the different responses, but they're all different interpretations of this possible metaphor. Somebody says, like in the middle there, I think the river's tent is the cover of trees and vegetation overhanging the river itself. One thing they do in close reading, of course, is to take a stand. They evaluate the text. So brown is a dull color, very boring and uneventful, there to describe life. And Travis writes, I don't think brown means uneventful. It seems that there's a lot happening here. So they disagree. And finally, what's interesting is they're, as I mentioned, they're not only evaluating the text, but they're evaluating each other. And this is where it becomes tricky, let's just say. So Javier writes, he has then highlighted the entire stanza, and he writes, the city has been deserted for some time, and no human activities can be observed in town, which is conveyed in these lines. The river bears no empty bottles, sandwich papers, silk handkerchiefs, etc. Even the bank executives have left for good, leaving no addresses. Yet the departure was not by choice for the majority. It was against their will. And Kevin writes, I like the way you deduce such vast knowledge. I bet Wikipedia is how you find all the work you do. Okay. Right, they get snarky with each other. They call each other out. They think, this is not quite honest of you. Is this actually your interpretation or somebody else's? Because if it's somebody else's, then you better cite it. I was really impressed by that. Okay, so that's kind of the close reading activity that I saw very much present in the social space. Now, hyperreading was also very, very apparent. So when our students are reading online in eComma, they're using all kinds of different tools. So here, somebody writes, Bryant writes, Léman is French for Lake Geneva and an archaic word for mistress. And of course, so where is he getting that from? So he, of course, is using online translators. They have all kinds of, what I was really amazed by was how mediated the whole activity was with all kinds of different tools. And they're using different tools. So if they're using a bilingual dictionary, it's the one that they know how to use, not necessarily anybody else. Google searches, they'll type in a word. And so here, the title is The Wasteland, and the fire sermon have to do with setting in the story. Eliot uses words such as dead earth and bare trees and blah, blah, blah. And again, Kevin writes, where did you Google that? Yes, I think some of the comments should be cited. So again, they are already aware that everybody is using all these different tools. It's just part of reading online now. This is now our new updated version, and it works in Drupal. So we still have the text to the left, and then you can see over here these different icons. This is a tag, and these are comments. So we have 6 people have made tags, and we have 44 comments. This is a cloud, so you can take all their comments, and we turn them into a word cloud. We also have then a cloud here. This does a word cloud of the text itself. So this is Jabberwocky, and by Lewis Carroll. And I was doing a kind of showing a group of foreign language people, so all different languages in the room. And I thought, well, maybe use Jabberwocky. That can at least simulate to a certain extent what it's like to be reading in a foreign language, because you're really trying to create meaning with others. So somebody highlights borogoves. All mimsy were the borogoves. And what they do is they put in a link here, because they're going out searching the web for what is a borogove. And of course, I had no idea, but there's something called Muppet Wiki, an entire wiki devoted to the Muppets, which is terrific, because every single referent in this poem has a visualization on it. So annotations, of course, as they're going off, that's another important point. Annotations are not just text to text, but text to other forms of media. And this is really important, obviously, for foreign languages in the foreign language context. Again, I was doing a Jabberwocky at a different conference, but people, so here, come to my arms, my Beamish boy. This is, Han says, is this positive or negative? And then somebody writes at a different Hans, writes in, I gave them about 4 names. You could either be Hans or Pierre or whatever. And they were just trying to say, does it work in Arabic? Does it work in Hebrew? But it also works in video. So that's an important point. So not only is it multilingual, but it's also multimodal glossing. That's hypermedia. They're constantly going out of the text to then bring back information in different ways. I was really interested in the kind of lack of use, actually, of this one machine reading tool, which is the word cloud, which is pretty basic. Most students know what a word cloud is. They know, they quickly look at it, and they realize it tells you information about the frequency, lexical frequency, how frequent a word is. The more frequent it is, the bigger it is, right, in the cloud. I started thinking of activities to promote the use of machine tools. And this was an activity I actually did in a graduate course focused on linguistic variation. So I gave them this text, Moté élevé ici en dedans la paroisse Saint-Martin, au roi Bayoutèche, en haut la terre, sur l'homme, au papa, t'es tarité la terre de son papa. Okay, this is not French. This is Creole French, or Louisiana Creole. And first of all, it's not a written language. So the people who are writing Creole French are usually literate in English and in French. So that means that they're borrowing, they're making it up. So what I had them do was look for variation, orthographic variation, and think about how that orthographic variation may have all kinds of different reasons. What's going on? So it's nice. You can click on the word, and of course, it highlights it in the text. And you quickly see then that here, mot, mon, and then mot with the apostrophe or with the accent, are they the same? What is this different? What is going on here and ask them to hypothesize. So that was my effort of trying to get them to use this one feature of our software that they weren't using very often. It also, another form of machine reading is a heat map. So as there's a lot of activity going on, and people, a whole class is marking up a text, parts of a text you can see quickly at a glance. This is the last line of the poem Liberté by Éluard. And the last stanza is, and by the power of a word, and the whole word he's leading up to is the word liberty, liberté. So this was heavily, everybody in the class had something to say about that last stanza. Let me get to my two case studies. How are people using this? Joanna, a lower division, the director of lower division French at Cornell, adopted eComma, and she was really interested in trying to, she had been reading the MLA report 2007, which talks about translingual, transcultural competence, this notion of movement between languages. And she said, so she was devised activities that explicitly invoked this kind of notion of moving between languages. So she wanted them to think deeply about what it means to translate. And she then, she was using materials that we'd started at the University of Texas for our French program, Français Interactif. And she said, I like them, but yes. They're not enough literary readings for me. I really want to supplement this with literary readings. I said, fine, go ahead, go to town. It's an open educational resource, so you can supplement it. She turned out to go well beyond what I thought our textbook was really all about, and I said, we need to package this as its own OER, which we called Le littéraire dans le quotidien, the literary in the everyday. And we're doing it now. It's kind of grown into a project. So there are other people who are developing literacy activities along these lines. But anyhow, if you're interested in that, you can go to our website. And it's called The Literary in the Everyday. But this is what she did. She gave them a friend. And I'm just giving you a small sample of the text. She chose some short prose poems. This Dany Laferrière is a Haitian poet. And what's interesting here is that he moved from Haiti to Montreal, huge change. And he chronicles, that's why it's called a chronique, he chronicles every single day something that he sees that just is startling to him. And what's interesting, though, is that the language is fairly simple. So she thought that it would be actually doable for first-year French students. So we have un couple en train de s'embrasser à l'aéroport, un baiser interminable, la fille est en mini-jupe rouge. Okay. So a couple who are embracing in the airport. Un baiser means a kiss, and interminable, interminable. The girl is in a red miniskirt. Okay, so this, a student wrote, and remember, the activity she told the students that they could, she wanted them to explicitly comment on in English on the text, to provoke a kind of this meta-awareness about moving between the two frames and moving between one language and what are the problematics of that. So the student highlighted interminable and writes, we're limited here by our ability to work with a word in French while not knowing exactly how it translates in English. Does interminable have the same exact meaning in French as it does in English? If so, then un baiser interminable carries a negative connotation, a kiss that's unbearably, almost annoyingly long and dragged out. But if in French, interminable may also translate to other less loaded words, such as perhaps endless, endless love. Then connotation changes. Perhaps the author isn't put off by the extravagance of the kiss. Okay, so the whole point is, and this is a very important point to drill home at the very beginning in foreign languages, cognates are not always your friends, okay? They're false friends, as we say. But that's just a representation of using the tool to raise their awareness about the problematics of meaning. Sometimes you lose something, sometimes you gain something. Another very different use of eComma was by Chantel Warner. Chantel, so the three of us are now working on the project, as I said, the literary and the everyday. But Chantel was teaching a graduate course at the time, and in SLA, in second language learning, called narrativity. And I've taken this from our website, where we actually have Joanna and Chantel recount their case studies of how they use this. But so she writes, I used eComma in a graduate level seminar titled Literacy Through Language, Literacy Through Literature. The course explores the role that literary text and aesthetic reading play in the development of second language literacies. Literacy is used here both in the traditional sense of reading, of the reading of a printed text, and in the wider sense of multiliteracies, which includes social and cultural literacies, as well as new media literacies. One of the readings for the course was a chapter from narratologist Ryan's book, Narrative as Virtual Reality, on immersivity and interactivity as two modes of reading narrative texts. At the end of this chapter, Ryan introduces an example from the book, If on a Winter's Night, a Traveler by Italo Corvino. So I see Guy Raffa nodding his head. Yes, I know that. I decided to use eComma to allow students to consider Ryan's distinction between immersive and interactive reading and to examine what kinds of pedagogical interventions might encourage one or the other mode of engagement. So what she basically did was, there's a point at which in the text, as he's telling the story, he turns to the reader, the narrator turns to the reader. It's very startling. If any of you have watched the House of Cards, right? No? You haven't watched House of Cards? So Francis Underwood, who's played by Kevin Spacey, turns to you, you're watching, and he addresses you directly. The first time it happens, it's quite startling. Now I've gotten used to it, right? But anyhow, there was a moment in the text, and she wanted to be there right then to follow their reactions. She was using eComma for that, creating a social space to catch their readers, to kind of talk about the phenomenology, what it feels like to be reading in that moment. So really, reader response. And again, I'm collecting case studies, so if those of you who are using eComma, you can go right here, this is our website, and take a look. Let me quickly end by talking a little bit about the affordances of social reading, or what I'm seeing then people thinking they can do with eComma. Social readers can visualize group behavior to grasp the concept of interpretive communities. I've used this before. I've given the same poem to different groups of readers and then said, I've done this with my students, and then turn around and give it to, let's say, native speakers. And the students are watching the annotations and thinking, oh, they're going to turn left. No, they turned right. So this is a kind of activity that I've never really been able to do before. So the notion of interpretive community, we can see the activity, it leaves a trace. Creates what I'm calling a ZPD. So this is, of course, from Vygotsky, this notion of what you can do by yourself versus what you can do with a more talented other, the expert. So it creates this space where you can do things that you couldn't do by yourself, but you have other people to help you. It, of course, lightens the cognitive load because you can distribute the task. So it's kind of a great example of distributed cognition. You know, I've seen the students actually, before they do a task in class, will talk about how they're going to divide and conquer the text. This is actually an important point, too. I never really thought about this as a teacher. When you give a text to your class, you assume that they're all going to read it in the same way. No. So that was really what's interesting, is how they actually talk out their interpretation or their strategies before they read the book, the text. It frees the text from the linearity of print. This, of course, may not be a great thing. It really depends on what you want to do. But because they're in a hypermedia text space, they jump all around. And finally, as I mentioned, it's the task of reading is mediated by all kinds of digital tools. The whole main point here is I'm trying to get across is to try to figure out the right mix of close, hyper, and machine reading, these different kinds of strategies, what works for which text. It's complicated. Let me end by citing another book, Proust and the Squid, The Story and Science of the Reading Brain. So Proust is to represent, of course, the incarnation of the humanist, the story of reading. Proust himself, of course, wrote a lot about reading and writing. So he did not just write literary texts, but he actually talked about reading literary texts. And the squid comes from Marianne Wolfe. The author is a neuroscientist. She's interested in the reading brain. And she looks at different kinds of organisms and their brain activity. So that's the idea of the squid. So she writes at the very end of her book, which again came out in 2007, which now is a long time ago. And so that means the manuscript was like 2005. It's published a couple years later. And the tipping point that Catherine Hayles talks about has not yet hit, but she's seeing this change in her students. So she writes, the question that emerges, therefore, is this. What would be lost to us if we replaced the skills honed by the reading brain with those now being formed in our new generation of digital natives who sit and read transfixed before a screen? I'd like to update her final quote and maybe just paraphrase this and say that I think the question should be, what could be gained if we bridge the skills honed by the print reading brain with those now being formed in our new generation of digital natives who sit and read with others before a screen? Again, in my Google search of images, this was actually my favorite example of social reading. It's not digital social reading, but it's the coolest technology of the 1960s or perhaps 50s, I don't know, 3D comic books, but that's pretty cool.